to Moments with Marianne. I'm so delighted we're spending this time here today. We have a phenomenal show coming right up with special guest Michelle Fondin. Now, Michelle's here to talk with us about her new book, Chakra Healing for Vibrant Energy. Now, Michelle is the author of several books, including The Wheel of Healing with Ayurveda, and she's the owner of Ayurvedic Path Yoga and Wellness Studio. She's an Ayurvedic lifestyle counselor and yoga and meditation teacher, and she holds a Vedic Master Certificate from the chopra-center and has worked with Deepak Chopra teaching yoga and meditation. So let's welcome to the show, Michelle.
Thank you so much, Marianne.
Oh, what a pleasure it is to have you here.
Oh, I appreciate that.
Well, I'm sorry, you have your brand new book that came out. How exciting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm really excited for this one. My first book with New World Library is all about Ayurveda, and this one really ties into the energy healing aspect of healing, and it's really exciting because while I explored it a little bit with the book on Ayurveda, I really didn't delve deeply into it, and this book gave me the opportunity to do that.
Well, it's so great because this book is all about chakras, and I think a lot of times people kind of, either they're new to their spiritual practice and try to learn about chakras, or even people that have been in their practice for a while may be a little confused on how some things work with them. So why don't you break it down? Like, what's a chakra?
So chakras are wheels of energy in the body. The word chakra is a Sanskrit word, and it literally means wheel or disc. And so just think about the energy within your body, and you can think of it as just like when you feel alive and when you feel happy and you feel vibrant, that's the vital energy in your body, and that's called prana or vital life force. And so we have seven main chakras in the body that start from the base of the spine and align the spine and move up through to the crown of the head. And each of the chakras, each of the seven main chakras represents different aspects of not only your physical body, but also your emotional body and your spiritual body and different aspects of your personality even.
Well, I think that it's so amazing that you know so much about this. And I'd love for you to share a little bit more with us. Like, how did you even get started on this path? What inspired you to do that?
So I first got on the yoga path when I was 18 years old, and I had a wonderful yoga teacher. I was a senior in high school, and actually she was my religion teacher, and she introduced me to yoga, but I didn't know a whole lot about the chakras until I was 28 years old, and I was diagnosed with thyroid cancer, and intuitively I just knew that I went through traditional treatments, so I did get 2 surgeries, radioactive iodine therapy, but at the same time, I knew there was something else I needed to do to look at healing on a much deeper level, because I was 28, and I was like, I'm not getting sick again, this is ridiculous, like, why did I get sick in the first place? And so I began the exploration, and one of the things I fell upon in my search in alternative healing was the chakras, and it made so much sense to me because of the thyroid cancer is in the area of the throat, and when I looked back at the throat chakra, the area of the throat throughout my life, I realized that throughout my entire life, I had always been sick in this throat. I grew up with tonsillitis, strep throat. When I was 17, I had mononucleosis, and I had an abscess in my throat that blocked the air passages. And so when I discovered more about the fifth chakra, I was like, oh my gosh, like there's something seriously wrong here. So it really made me interested in learning how to open up that particular area of my body and to help my healing on a really deep level.
Well, I'm so glad that you shared that with us, because a lot of times I find it interesting when we have, you know, something that's going on, it's usually like a repetitive thing. Or
yeah.
Even in this case, it's like you're so young when this happened, and so you're like, mm-hmm. This is not happening again. I'm going to figure out what the deal is and work through it. But
yeah.
I really applaud you for that. And it gives a lot of people hope, because it doesn't matter what age you are, these things can happen, and it deserves a deeper look.
Yeah, and I think one of the things is, like, taking responsibility for what's happening to your body. It doesn't mean, like, you're blaming yourself for that happening, but it's more about looking at what are the circumstances in my life? What are my life experiences? What am I holding on to that I no longer need? What kind of lifestyle am I living? And really taking that deeper exploration, because oftentimes people look at it as bad luck, or they look at it as, oh, gosh, why are these things always happening to me in this area of my body? Like, you know, women who experience, like, fertility problems, they're like, you know, why is this happening to me when my friends are having babies? Or, and it's better to look at it from perspective of how can I rebalance that area of my body so that I can heal that aspect so that I can have a healthy and productive life.
Well, and you brought up something that I think is kind of really profound. You talked initially about having just these problems in a certain area, you know, so when that happens, you know, is that a chakra getting blocked? And if so, what does it mean when they get blocked?
Right. So it can mean that the chakra is blocked. It can also mean that there's either depletion of energy in that area, so meaning like the area is being restricted or constricted or deprived of energy, and it also can mean excess energy in the area, meaning there's too much energy going to that area. So I think the first step is understanding which ailments or which symptoms that you typically have when you're starting to go out of balance. And most people know this. Most people know that, hey, when I'm starting to go out of balance, I always get a scratchy throat. Or when I'm getting out of balance, I always get like IBS or irritable bowels. So most people understand their bodies a little bit, even on a very subtle level, where they know that when I'm going out of balance, I know which part of my body tends to get out of balance first. So the first thing is really just to bring awareness to that area of your body that you know that each time you're, you know, you're stressed out at work or you're stressing your relationships or, you know, maybe there's just something that's going on in with your kids and your other parts of your family. And you know that, like, when you hold on to stress, where you hold on to it. So it's looking at that first and bringing awareness to that area of the body. And then thinking about what is making me ill in this part of my body. And so the first thing is bringing awareness to it and just thinking back, like connecting the steps, just the way that I connected the steps through my throat chakra. I connected the steps of my throat becoming sick throughout my life because I wasn't able to verbally express myself well throughout childhood. I grew up in a fairly dysfunctional and abusive household, and so one of the things was I had to be the good girl. And being the good girl is you don't speak your truth, you people please. So I really had to like connect those steps and look at, okay, so the area of the throat, not being able to speak my truth, why am I not able to speak my truth, and how can I heal that? So I think it's awareness and then looking back to your past and then being able to connect the steps as to why that area gets blocked in the first place.
Well, and if you're working with somebody and they're like, they've got many different things going on and they can't find at the root of why they're having some kind of blockage or where that is, how do you work with somebody like that?
Yeah, you know, and what I say is that sometimes it doesn't come to you right away. Healing is multifaceted, it's multi-leveled, and it's, and as we start to heal, we uncover the layers of what might be hidden. And so a really good place to start is get into a really good energy moving practice. So for example, taking a Tai Chi class, Qigong, or yoga class that with a really compassionate teacher. I know a lot of the yoga that's out there is either fitness yoga or in a gym or maybe with some teachers that aren't as experienced with energy healing, but trying to find, you know, a teacher or practice that is geared more toward energy healing. And sometimes just by doing a weekly practice, you don't even have to go 5 days a week. You can go once or twice a week. And as you start to really tune into your body, then the intelligence of your body will be revealed to you. Another thing that I really recommend is a daily meditation practice. And if you don't know meditation, in the book there's actually guided meditations for each of the chakras. And in the audio book, I have a particular tract that does all seven of the guided meditations. So you could listen to them sequentially. But yeah, so getting into a good meditation practice, getting into a good yoga, and I say Tai Chi and Qigong because I really love all of those practices, and I believe they all bring about energy healing. And sometimes when you just start those practices with the intention of becoming aware of what's going on in your body and mind, it'll start to be revealed to you.
Well, and I agree with you. I mean, not all yoga teachers or equal.
And so, it's always good to test it out and see which one really resonates with you and just how long the teacher's been doing it or, you know, just where they are in their ability to bring the person to the next level in their yoga practice. Because I've been to some yoga studios where, it's not quite where a person should start, and others where there's a lot of compassion in the practice.
Yeah, and I think too, I've been a yoga teacher for 10 years, and my practice was always spiritual in nature, whereas I understand that it doesn't make it wrong, it's just a different focus. I understand that a lot of yoga classes, especially in like gyms or certain yoga centers, it's focused more on physical fitness, and so it's more about the energy. With the energy healing, you really want to find more of the centers or the teachers that are more geared toward a more spiritual practice that can help you, especially if healing is your main focus.
Well, I know that you have actually taught with some of, you've done yoga with some of the best. Why don't you share about that with us? Because I think it's something to be proud of.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, so I trained and studied with Dr. Deepak Chopra, Dr. David Simon, Claire Diab at the Chopra Center, David G., who's a Hay House author, actually. And through that, I taught at the Deepak Chopra's conferences all through 2009-2010. I taught yoga and I taught meditation at his programs. And so it was neat. It was a great environment because I was really able to teach in these large groups of people, but they were also being really supported through learning meditation and learning about Ayurveda and all these other healing practices. And that was a really special time in my life, and unfortunately I wasn't able to continue it too much. I have 3 kids. They were small at the time, and that required a little bit of travel. But I still hold in my heart, I just hold that close to my heart because it was a fantastic experience, and Deepak Chopra is still, one of my mentors. And even growing up, and it was funny, I was reading out of the 7 Spiritual Laws of Success, and that book was published by my publisher, New World Library, and it kind of brought a tear to my eye when I opened up the book last night as I was teaching a class, because I thought, wow, when I picked up this book, which was published in 94, I was like, I never knew that journey would bring me here to being with the same publisher and teaching about this stuff. It was just so beautiful how everything tied together.
I've sat on this program before, and if the river itself, if the ocean's salvation, there are many rivers that lead to it. It's interesting. We always end up where we should be.
Exactly.
We talked about the chakras, and we've talked about yoga. So how do these things combine? Because we talked about, someone that's using yoga in a spiritual sense. How does that relate to chakra work?
Well, the chakras, the chakras come from a similar body of knowledge that yoga and meditation and Ayurveda come from. They all originate from India and Indian philosophy, and the chakras originate from the tantric texts, which a lot of people, when they hear the word tantra, they think automatically of sex or sexuality, when in reality, that's just a westernized simplification of the chakras or of tantra. In reality, what it's really about energy healing and opening up the areas of your body which can be blocked, or opening up that kundalini energy that you might have heard when you hear about tantra, you hear about kundalini yoga even. But through the practices of meditation and yoga, that is the vehicle or the way that you can get to opening up your chakras according to tantra. And it's also about a lot of other disciplinary practices. So if you have heard of the 8 limbs of yoga, for example, which are the philosophical aspect of yoga, the ways of living, tantra also talks about that. And when they do talk about sexuality, which is mentioned in a tantric text, but it's really for the most advanced yogis, and it's mostly about discipline. It's about self-discipline. It's about austerity, living a very disciplined life, getting up early to meditate, showing restraint and not overdoing it. And so the two do tie together, the two you know, yoga meaning union and the chakra healing do tie together, because yoga, meditation, Ayurveda are all vehicles to get you to healing your chakras.
I'm so glad that you talked about that. Because most people, myself included, you hear about tantra yoga and you're like, oh, that's, you know, it can get into some very interesting places, and it seems to be very sexualized.
Plus, I think what people advertise, like, even if you look up tantra on YouTube, you get a bunch of stuff that's not pure, I should say. It brings about these, you know, it brings about, and, you know, and there's this misconception, really. There's this misconception about, now, that doesn't mean, I've taught a couple of yoga classes, and that doesn't mean that practices like yoga, practices like, you know, chakra healing and chakra opening and meditation can bring couples together. I mean, that's a wonderful way to enhance a relationship and then enhance, you know, a marriage. And I think it's just a great way to open up to another level of healing together in your relationships. It's beautiful and wonderful. I think, unfortunately, it becomes more of a, you know, it's kind of like a forbidden practice, this kind of like dirty practice, when it's not like that at all. It really should be, it should be seen as something that, yeah, once you start to heal yourself, of course your relationships are going to heal.
Well, doesn't that just make sense? My goodness.
Mm-hmm.
You know? Because you look at just from, I mean, you look at the chakras and the energy that it provides the body, and when they're blocked, what happens, and when they're functioning efficiently, you know, just how much better life can be.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I think, too, that, you know, when you bring more awareness to your body and then you are able to see the slight imbalances that are happening in each of the areas of the body, or in those key areas, like I mentioned before, those key areas that you tend to get sick in. And, you know, the Ayurvedic doshas, definitely that's part of it, because the Ayurvedic mind-body types of Vata, Pitta, and Kapha, they also kind of govern where you're going to tend to get sick in the body and where you tend to get more balanced in the body. And so it's really, when you become aware of these subtle changes in your body, then you don't have to experience illness. And really, that's what alternative healing or complementary healing is more about. It's not about like, oh, I'm going to heal this stage 4 cancer with chakra practice or with Ayurvedic practice. It's, miracles do happen, and I wholeheartedly believe in miracles. But it's more about preventive health, and it's about looking at what you can do to remain in balance, because we're constantly going out of balance. So it's really that self-awareness. Yeah, it's about that self-awareness to be able to prevent disease from happening in the first place.
Well, and so my next question, it's kind of a loaded question here, so you're just going to love this. So in your book, you talk about the third chakra. Okay, so what's the third chakra, and why is it different between men and women?
Okay, sure. So the third chakra is the area of the solar plexus. It's our source of personal power. It's our ego expression into the world. Now, when students of yoga, or when people who are deep into yogic philosophy, hear this word ego, they think like, oh, the ego is a bad thing. We have to get rid of the ego. We have to transcend the ego. And Ayurvedic philosophy does not say that. You know, the tantric philosophy does not say that. It says like, that's our personal power. That's our personal expression of ourselves. That's our personality that moves forth out into the world. We need this third chakra energy, this solar plexus energy, this source of personal power, to be able to go out and get a job. We need it to go out and woo someone to become our lover or spouse. Like, we need that energy. We need that personal power. And to be able to stand up for ourselves and speak our truth, speak our personal power, we need that energy first. So the chakras themselves, from the first chakra through the fifth chakra, have yin and yang alternating energy. So yin and yang, so the yin energy is the female energy, the more lunar, passive energy. And the yang energy is the more solar energy. So it is more aggressive. It's the masculine energy. It's the get-up-and-go attitude type of energy. And so the first chakra starts with this yang energy. Then the second chakra, which is our sexual and creativity chakra, goes to the yin energy. And by the time we get to the third, we alternate back to the yang energy, which is that solar. Think of the sun. It's hot, right? The sun can be very aggressive when it's really hot. So it's that heating, masculine, forward-moving energy. So those are the differences of that. And so when we talk about the dynamic between our female and male energies, which everybody has that, everybody has alternating female and male energies, we talk about that the third chakra is more of a masculine type of energy. And in this society, in the American society that we live in overall in Western societies in general, we tend to live a lot in the third chakra, in the third chakra energy. It's all about, like, getting to the goal. Let's meet our quota. Let's move up the corporate ladder. And it's all about go, 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 go. And sometimes it can be detrimental not only to our health, especially our heart health, but it can be detrimental to women in general in forgetting, for the woman, forgetting to embrace that feminine energy as well as the masculine energy.
Well, it's so important because women have so much strength in their femininity. You know, mm-hmm. it's not that we always have to turn on the masculine to exude that, you know.
Exactly.
Well, and so, you know, I actually am kind of curious about this. So with the crown chakra, do you mm-hmm. ever see where people have that blocked?
Yes.
It's how does that even happen?
You're saying the crown chakra?
Mm-hmm.
So basically, the crown chakra can be blocked in a number of ways, but one of the ways is that the lower chakras have not been opened and aligned. So if the lower chakras haven't been open and aligned, then there's no pathway to get up to the crown chakra. And you see this, you see it in a couple of ways. So you see the crown chakra blocked when people have no sense of spirituality, when they believe that there is nothing beyond the physical, when they're very skeptical, when you see this skepticism and cynicism in people where they claim to be atheists, or they say, like, I don't believe in anything beyond the physical, and this is just the way we are, and, you know, we're just born here to die, and that's it. There's only this lifetime. So we hear people like that can't seem to connect to beyond the physical, because from the fourth chakra up, it's connecting to the spiritual energy. And then the other flip side that we see with a crown chakra that is blocked is this excessiveness into religious doctrine. And so we see people that have this spiritual elitism where they feel superior to others. And they feel superior because they're following the rules of their particular religious doctrine. And so those are the two kinds of spectrum that we see when we see a blocked crown chakra.
That is really interesting. I was very curious to hear what you had to say on that because, you know, when you think that the crown chakra is blocked and all the chakras are blocked, but you talk about health and the fourth chakra up, you know, it's connected to spirit. So how about the chakras going down?
I'm sorry, so what was... The chakras going down, the blockages. Would you like me to explain each of the chakras and their blockages?
Sure. I think that would be perfect.
Yeah, we can go quickly. Well, we started at the crown. So the third eye chakra, which often we see as far as blockages go, is not paying attention to your intuition or missing things. In that case, so that's the third eye. So it's in between the eyebrows. That's our sight, right? It's our sixth sense. It's our sense of intuition. And so we see people like missing things where, you know, things are right in front of them, opportunities, and they tend to have bad luck, quote unquote, because they don't see things. They don't see things with their third eye. Another thing is problems with the eyes, like blurred vision, you know, extreme eye problems. Those are the types of things that we tend to see in the third eye. The throat chakra, we talked about, it's people that feel suppressed, like they can't speak their truth. They could have speech impediments, literally. They could have a stutter. They could have throat problems, you know, constant, you know, you hear people sometimes that constantly clear their throats. They're always sick or they have some sort of throat, you know, problem where they get laryngitis or they're really not able to speak clearly. And oftentimes you see them, and a lot of times you see them as people pleasers, as I mentioned with myself growing up, that, you know, they're just trying to play nice and not be truthful. Someone who lies all the time, that is someone who has a blocked throat chakra, because throat chakra is literally about speaking your higher truth, being able to openly express yourself and speak your higher truth. The heart chakra, so the most obvious are having heart problems, congestive heart failure, heart disease. We look at things that, like, the what's behind the heart and the heart chakra are the bronchial passages in the lungs, so any of the diseases that are surrounding the bronchial passages in the lungs, thyroid problems, thymus gland problems, parathyroid gland problems. I'm looking at the heart and opening up to love and letting yourself be vulnerable to love and also being able to receive love. A lot of people have an easy time giving love, but they have a hard time receiving love. And so then we get to the third chakra, which is the manipura, the solar plexus, which we just talked about, and the solar plexus, and really that's more about stepping out in the world and taking risks and being able to just open up to going for what it is that you want, like moving towards your goals and successfully accomplishing your goals. People that have a deficiency in that third chakra, oftentimes you see them starting things. They start projects because they're excited to start. They have the fire energy to start the projects, but they don't often finish them because they don't have that inner drive and that feeling of personal power. And also, like, standing up for your rights, being able to stand up for what it is that you believe in, standing up for yourself in your own personal power. And we often see problems like stomach issues, digestive disturbances, bloating. A lot of times if you see bloating, or, you know, the men after 40 that tend to get that tummy, or even women after 40 that tend to get that tummy, really what that's showing is a blocked third chakra. It's not being able to move forward in your personal power to express yourself. Then the second chakra, the sexual chakra, a lot of times we see fertility problems. We see people that aren't able to conceive or repeated miscarriages for women. We see maybe sexual dysfunction in men. And that's all about the creative force. So it's not only giving life force, but it's also about your creativity and your creative projects and honoring, again, that feminine energy, which is all about creation and creativity. And then the root chakra, which is our sense of security, having our basic needs met on earth. And that's all about creating money. It's about having that sense of security in order to feel like all of your basic needs are met. And so people that have financial problems, people that have problems with being able to keep a job, for example, or having a stable household or living in a certain place, those are all the kinds of things that you see with blockages in the first chakra.
Now, helping people to, like, clear their blockages, other than purchasing your book, do you do sessions with people?
I personally don't do sessions. I'm actually learning Reiki now, but I would say there are fantastic Reiki practitioners that can do energy healing for you, and finding the right, like, Reiki teacher that can do chakra opening. I do yoga. That's how I usually do it. I do yoga classes. And, of course, I have many YouTube videos up that I have done guiding you through yoga poses for the chakras, as well as breathing techniques, the pranayama yoga breathing techniques, to help open and align the chakras as well. So, yeah, there are a lot of different ways you can actually do this with, you know, yoga, again, the yoga breathing, the guided meditations, and some energy healing.
Wow, that just sounds so perfect. And so what are some ways that we can support healthy chakras, you know, going forward. So we get your book. What are some of the other ways we can do that?
So definitely by eating a healthy lifestyle. In my book and in also in the Wheel of Healing with Ayurveda, I really talk about eating an Ayurvedic lifestyle that's specific to your Ayurvedic mind-body type. Eating clean, you know, and most of the books that I do write, I write about eating clean. And what is eating clean? Eating clean is as much as you can, buying organic food, buying local food, eating fresh fruits and vegetables, eating whole grains, staying away from artificial foods, staying away from microwaved foods and leftovers. You know, I know in this American society we like to pre-cook on the weekend so we can have lunches and dinners throughout the week, or we like to freeze things, but Ayurveda really teaches about eating wholesome foods that are fresh, and the fresher they are, the more that prana or vital life force or that vital energy you'll have in your body. So eating clean is huge. It's huge. It makes a huge difference in your life and your health, and I know it takes a lot of times extra money, extra time, but it's so worth it. The second thing is drinking clean water. You know, I talk in another one of my books called Enlightened Medicine, I talk about, you know, reverse osmosis water, or some people like to drink the high alkaline water, but even just, you know, the reverse osmosis water is really good for you. You know, it gets rid of the toxins in your body. Drink lots of water. Stay away from things like alcohol and fruit juices and just, you know, things that are going to be high in sugar and that are going to be more detrimental to your body, just to keep you balanced. The thing is it's all about balance, and water is really the only thing you need to drink. And just eating holistically, and those are some of the things that you can do today to start. You don't even have to pick up the book, but you can start with your everyday diet.
Good. And what are your thoughts on coffee and tea? For people that,
well, you know, I am, my only vice is coffee, but I just, you know, I limit it. I limit my coffee consumption to 1 to 2 cups a day. That's it. Sometimes I only have 1 cup a day. You know, if you're drinking teas, you know, and it has to do with your mind-body type too, and what else, you know, what other things are you doing? So everything as far as, like, things like coffee and tea and, you know, very moderation, but you have to know your body. If you find, for example, that you are drinking, let's say you have your morning cup of tea or your morning cup of coffee, but you find that you're agitated and you're nervous and you tend to be snapping at people or just, you know, just nervous and have that racing mind, then that's an indication that for your mind-body type, for the type of person that you are, that your body is just hypersensitive to these things and it just can't handle it. So it's best to read into what's good for your body, but not overdoing it, not excessive.
I think that's so important to listen to your body, because even, like, I'll go to a new coffee shop and have a cup of coffee and later on feel like I've had 10. So
yeah.
You don't have to gauge where you are with all these things.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and, like, you know, you can always wean yourself off. I know, like I said, coffee is the only vice I have. I don't drink. I don't do anything. Like, I don't do sugar beverages at all. But there are periods where if I know I'm experiencing high stress in my life, that I have a lot going on, then I do tune in, and I will not drink coffee during those periods. I'll just say, nope, I'm just going to opt to either do decaf or just drink some. I'm mostly a Vata type and the Ayurvedic mind-body type, but I mostly drink a Vata tea, which is just a very calming type tea. So think of something like chamomile tea or something. So it's a very calming type tea, and so I'll just drink that for a week or so until I feel that my body is feeling healthier and calmer. And then, you know, if I want to start my coffee again, I'll do that.
Well, I know we're connected on social media, where I get to watch all the great things that you post in regards to chakras and just life in general. Where can our listeners connect with you and learn more about being part of your community?
Absolutely. So I'm big into YouTube. So my YouTube channel is Michelle Fondin Author, where I post 4 to 6 videos a week all about healthy living, and in particular, these next few weeks, all about the chakras. And also, my website is michellefondinauthor.com.
Well, and I know your book is available at all major retailers, Amazon, Barnes & Noble, any place you can buy a book, your book is there.
Absolutely.
Well, you, Michelle, thank you so much for taking the time to be on the show with us here today.
Thank you so much, Marianne. I really appreciate it. Thanks for having me on.
Well, thank you, Michelle. It's been such a joy to spend this time with you. We are at the end of our time today. I would like to thank everyone for tuning in. You've been listening to Moments with Marianne. And remember, make every moment count.
In a single moment, your life can change. Moments with Marianne is a transformative hour that covers an endless array of topics with the best of the best. Her guests are leaders in their fields, ranging from inspirational authors, top industry leaders, and business and spiritual entrepreneurs. Each guest is gifted and a true visionary, a recognized leader in her own work, and while teaching others to develop, refocus, and grow, Marianne will bring the best guest and sometimes a special surprise. Don't miss this. You never know just which moment will change your life forever. Moments with Marianne airs every Thursday, Friday, and Sunday at 8 p.m. Eastern, 6 p.m. Mountain Time. Make sure to tune in and visit MomentsWithMarianne.com for more information.